Well, good morning. We have a very important and very solemn message to consider today. The title of the message is The Ecumenical Movement, Closer Than You Think. The Ecumenical Movement, Closer Than You Think. In Psalms 133 and verse 1, David says, "Behold, how good and pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." And unity is a wonderful thing. It's a pleasant thing to dwell together in unity. The Hebrew word for unity, it comes actually from two words, gam and yached. Gam means also, and yached is similar to echad, and it means to be united. The ecumenical philosophy that has spread widely within Christianity has its roots actually not in the Bible, but in the teachings of Satan. Some of us are old enough to know or to remember, to at least hopefully all of us read about maybe, the Vatican II Council that was convened in 1962, first called by Pope John XXIII in 1959. And this is one of the Catholic Church's what they call ecumenical councils. It was the second Vatican Ecumenical Council. And its theme was ecumenism, how to draw the churches all toward Rome. It's the theme. The ecumenical movement is the theme of the World Council of Churches. You've heard about the World Council of Churches. It's an organization that has over 300 different church denominations in it. And their theme is unity. Now, how do you get into the World Council of Churches? Well, I thought you might want to know. Churches which agree with the World Council of Church basis are eligible to apply for World Council of Churches membership. This is from their own website. I accessed this last night. I know it's current. And so it says that we have to agree with the basis. So what is the basis of the World Council of Churches? Well, here is the basis of the World Council of Churches from their own website again. The World Council of Churches is a fellowship of churches which confess the Lord Jesus Christ as God and Savior according to the Scriptures and therefore seek to fulfill together their common calling to the glory of the one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. So the basis is you believe in the Trinity. The one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. And if you believe in the Trinity, it really doesn't matter what else you believe or how you believe on anything else. Because if you believe this, you have this one single common denominator. And that binds them all together. On their website, they also state the World Council of Churches is the broadest and most inclusive among the many organized expressions of the modern what? Ecumenical movement, a movement whose goal is Christian unity. And it's Christian unity based upon what?
The Trinity.
The one God, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Keep that in mind. So the ecumenical movement within the World Council of Churches, it has as its lowest common denominator the doctrine of the Trinity. After that, you can believe about anything you wish. Mm-hmm. Have you ever heard of something called the emerging church? The emerging church. The ecumenical philosophy is the central core to the emerging church. Brian McLaren, a leader of the emerging church philosophy, illustrates this on the cover of his book, A Generous Orthodoxy. And in the subtitle, or on the cover there, he says, "Why I am a missional, evangelical, post-Protestant, liberal-slash-conservative, mystical-slash-poetic, biblical-charismatic-slash-contemplative, fundamentalist-slash-Calvinist, Anabaptist-slash-Anglican, Methodist, Catholic, Green, Incarnational, depressed yet hopeful, emergent, unfinished Christian." And he has chapters in his book that go through all these things, why he's Catholic in belief, why he's Methodist in belief, why he's all these things. Ian Mobsby suggests that Trinitarian ecclesiology is the basis of the shared international values of the emerging church. He's one of the leaders of the emerging church philosophy. Mobsby also suggests that the emerging church is centered on a combination of models of church and of contextual theology that draws on this Trinitarian basis, on a Trinitarian basis, you see. It says, according to Mobsby, the emerging church has reacted to the missional needs of postmodern culture and reacquired a Trinitarian basis to its understanding of church as worship, mission, and community. Now notice, again, that the one principle is the belief about God. And of course, that God in this case is the Trinity. Everything else can be laid off the table, but this one thing is vital, this one thing is essential. Now, I'm going to just bring in something that seems a little strange at the moment, but you'll see why I'm bringing it in. And that is, I want to talk just for a little bit about Freemasonry. Because it is an attempt, it's a type of ecumenical attempt to bridge all religions. They subscribe to what is called the G-A-O-T-U theory. That is the great architect of the universe theory. That God is the great architect of the universe. And so, as long as you believe in one God, you may become a Freemason. One Mason explained it this way. This is from Christopher Hafen's book, Workman Unashamed, A Testimony of a Christian Freemason. And he says this, "Now imagine me standing in lodge with my head bowed in prayer between Brother Mohammed Bakari and Brother Ajurn Melwani. To neither of them is the great architect of the universe perceived as the Holy Trinity. To Brother Bakari, he has been revealed as to Brother Melwani, he is probably perceived as Vishnu. Since I believe that there is only one God, I am confronted with three possibilities." Here they are. They are praying to the devil, whilst I am praying to God. They are praying to nothing, as their gods do not exist. Or the third option, he says, they are praying to the same God as I, yet their understanding of his nature is partly incomplete, as indeed is mine, he says. 1 Corinthians 13:12. And then, he says, it is without hesitation that I accept the third possibility. Christopher Hafen from Workman Unashamed. Now, maybe you've heard of the what's called the Blue Lodge. And in the Blue Lodge, which is the basic fundamental level of Masonry, you receive what are called the first, second, and third degrees. But then there's another lodge above that. It's called the Scottish Rite. And in the Scottish Rite, you receive the fourth through the 32nd degrees of Freemasonry. And on their website, the Scottish Rite of Freemasonry's website, there's a question asked, is Freemasonry or the Scottish Rite a religion? And their answer is, no. While it is a requirement that each member believes in a supreme being, it is not important how one expresses that very personal belief. Further, there is no dogmatic system in Freemasonry. Confusion about the secular nature of Freemasonry, however, has been a common misconception for many years. Most likely, this misconception is due to the holy book that sits on the altar in the middle of a Masonic lodge. This holy book does not have to be Christian, like the Bible. Rather, it can be any holy book that is important to the members of the lodge. In the U.S., where the population is mostly Christian, the holy book most often in lodges is the King James Version of the Bible. Interesting. So if you were Muslim, you would have a Quran on the altar in the Masonic Lodge, or something else for some other religion. As long as you believe in one supreme deity, you're in. Again, this is the lowest common denominator. If we just believe in the same God, we should be able to get together. Now, friends, Satan knows that he probably can't fool Adventism with such an idea, right? Right? It may be closer than you think. It may be closer than you think. But notice the thread in all these versions of ecumenical teaching. You believe in one God, yet even among the many different groups, there are different interpretations as to who that one God is and what he or in some cases, she is like. But before we go further, let's see what the scripture says about this ecumenical philosophy. I'd like to invite you to turn your Bibles to Titus chapter 1 and verse 9. Titus 1:9. He says, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayer. Paul here speaks about sound doctrine, the necessity to have sound doctrine, and that we are to hold fast idle tales. Does he say idle tales? What are we to hold fast? The faithful word that has been taught. The faithful word. In 2 Timothy, just a page back probably in your Bible, chapter 4 and verse 3, it says, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers, having itching ears. And then he says, and shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned into fables. And so we're living in that time. People don't want to hear sound doctrine. They want to turn away from it. And yet, the ecumenical movement says sound doctrine is not important. You can believe what you want about the second coming of Christ. You can believe what you want about the resurrection and many other things, as long as you believe in God. In 1 Timothy chapter 1, 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 3, Paul says, as I besought thee to abide still at Ephesus, when I went into Macedonia, that thou mightest charge some that they teach no other doctrine. Paul had laid out teachings, and he says that they were not to teach any other doctrine. Does that match the ecumenical philosophy? That we're all just going to come together. We'll have communion together. We'll pray together. We'll testify together. And it's going to draw us together. Well, it will have an effect of drawing people together. That's true. But not in truth. In Jude, if we go to the book of Jude, just before Revelation, right? It's the last book of the Bible except for Revelation. Just before Revelation. Jude chapter 1, it only has one chapter, but verse 3. He says, beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and exhort you that ye should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. He says there was a faith that was delivered unto the saints. It's the faith of the Old Testament. It's the faith of the New Testament. It's the faith of the whole Bible. It's the faith that God gave our Adventist pioneers, beloved. And I'd like to say today that I want to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith that was delivered into our Adventist pioneers.
Amen.
Because they had truth. And God gave them truth. Now, in verse 3 here, it speaks about, I gave all diligence. Gave all diligence. Spunden is the Greek word. And it means to make haste. To make haste. So he says, I gave all diligence. He says, I was hasty about this. I was making haste. I was trying to do this quickly. I didn't want to be undone. I didn't want to be late. You see, it was so important to Paul that he wanted to get it done. I gave diligence to write unto you about these things. And friends, we are to make haste to defend the faith. Friends, it is not possible to fight for the faith that has been revealed to the saints and to be ecumenical at the same time. These programs are antithesis one to the other. Fighting for the faith is to the ecumenical mind a divisive thing. It causes dissension. It ruins harmony. But we are told in Ephesians chapter 4, verses 5 and 6, he says, one Lord, one faith. How many faiths?
One.
One baptism. One God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. Ephesians 4, 5, and 6. He doesn't say that we have many faiths. He says we have one faith. And that one faith comes from the one true God. But not a false one true God. Not just any one true God. But the Father himself. The Bible teaches, friends, there is one faith. There is one doctrine, not many. There's only one true Christian faith, and we've been given the Holy Spirit so that we can know this one true faith And we are required to teach that faith, and only that faith, to others. Beloved, the ecumenical philosophy, it is unscriptural, and it is impossible. I say this kindly, but it is impossible to reconcile a faithful stand for biblical doctrine with any sort of ecumenicalism. It is impossible to stand for all the doctrines of the Bible, to contend for the faith that was once delivered unto the saints, and to be ecumenical in any sense. Now, this ecumenical philosophy, God knew it was going to come in. And he wrote throughout the Bible abundantly in places to help us to know that this would be wrong. And it's refuted by the Bible's warnings against false teachers who preach heresies. Because after all, think about it. If this ecumenical movement says we all can come together basically regardless of what we believe, then what's the point about having heresies? What's the point about preaching against heresies or warning people against heresies? Because it doesn't matter. We can all come together. But notice what Paul said to the church in Galatia, or the churches actually, it was a series of churches. Galatia was a province, and there was obviously more than one church. But notice here in chapter 1, Galatians chapter 1, and I'll start in verse 6. He says, I marvel that ye are so soon removed from him that called you into the grace of Christ unto another gospel. And that word another means a different kind of gospel, not the gospel that I've taught you. And then in verse 7 he says, which is not another, but it's a different word in the Greek than the other word translated another. It's allos. It's not the same kind of gospel that I've given you. But there be some that trouble you and would pervert the gospel of Christ. But though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be in your fellowship. No. Let's just all get together. We'll have communion. We'll have a study. We'll sing. We'll have a singspiration. It says, let him be accursed. The Greek word is anathema. You've heard that word. Verse 9, as we said before, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that ye have received, let him be accursed. Paul says, I've told you this before, I'm telling you again, he is putting emphasis upon this very point. In Philippians chapter 3, verses 17 and 18, he says, brethren, be followers together of me, and mark them which walk so as ye have for an ensample. For many walk, of whom I have told you oft, and now tell you, even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. So friends, if we're not walking according to the teachings of the New Testament, and especially, of course, the whole Bible even, then Paul says that we are enemies of the cross of Christ. Is that strong? Mm-hmm. Well, it's probably unkind. Maybe Paul shouldn't have said it. It might seem rude to someone. It might hurt their feelings. You know, friends, I'm glad God didn't entrust me to write the Bible. I'm sure it'd be very much different. I would have been too hard in some places, and I've been too soft in some places, and I surely wouldn't have been wise. But I want to tell you, God wrote everything in the Bible just exactly as it needs to be for us. Amen. And there's a reason it's like this, and he knows what's best. And when he says that if we're teaching false doctrines, we are enemies of the cross of Christ, that's exactly what he means. And if he says here, if he says this here, then we need to take heed, and this is a great warning. He also warns against the worldly teachings coming to the church from the world and even from professed believers. I think that I heard in Sabbath school a text from Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8 was mentioned, at least alluded to. But if we could turn back to Colossians chapter 2 and verse 8. Colossians 2 verse 8. The Apostle Paul gives a warning here. Colossians is just right after Philippians there. Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men, and after the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ. Now, the Greek word that's translated rudiments is sochia, and it means the basic principles which underlie the nature of something. The basic principles which underlie the nature of something. And so some different translations have translated this expression, for instance, the elemental spirits, the basic principles, or the elemental forces. Paul is saying that at its fundamental level, the basic principles or elements of the world are false philosophy. They are vain deceit, and yet they are accepted by some as a part of Christianity. And we are not and cannot accept that. So Paul's given us warnings, and we could look at many other warnings from Paul. But let's just look at a couple other things from Peter and John also. In 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. You know, sometimes we think that, well, I have to be careful what I listen to in the world. Because we know the world's not Christian, right? But notice again, very carefully, that most of the time these teachings that we are being warned about, they come from the not just simply the world, but from the church, or those within the professed church. He says here in 2 Peter chapter 2 and verse 1, but there were false prophets also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in what? Damnable heresies. Now, wait a minute. A heresy is something that causes a division. We usually consider it a false doctrine, something that's not truly orthodox. I use orthodox in the strict biblical sense, in the correct biblical sense. Orthodox is from two words. It means straight truth. But it says that they are damnable heresies, and that means that they bring damnation. They bring a person to a position of being lost. Right? That's what it means. So think about it. So anything that people teach, it's not salvational. Or people say, well, you know, it's not so important. We'll look at a text in a minute, and we'll talk about the importance of things. But it says, even denying the Lord that bought them and bring upon themselves swift destruction. And many shall follow their pernicious ways, by reason of whom the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. He says, yes, they're going to hell. But there's people going to follow them right there. People going to follow them right into hell. I tell you, read the whole chapter. The whole chapter is about this very point. We don't have time this morning to read it, but you can read the whole chapter. I encourage you to do that later. John warned about false teachers in many places. Let's go to 1 John chapter 4. 1 John chapter 4 and verses 1, 2, and 3. He says, beloved, believe not every spirit, but try the spirits whether they are of God, because many false prophets are gone out into the world. Hereby know ye the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is of God, and every spirit that confesses not that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of Antichrist, whereof ye have heard that it should come, and even now already is in the world. John didn't mince any meat. Well, we read in Jude that we should contend earnestly for the faith that was once delivered to the saints, didn't we? What verse was that in?
Three.
But let's go also just a few pages over and read the next verse, verse 4 now. Jude 4. He says, for there are certain men crept in unawares, who were before of old ordained to this condemnation, ungodly men, turning the grace of our God into lasciviousness and denying the only Lord God and our Lord Jesus Christ. So he says that there were certain men, and how did they come in among the believers? It says they crept in unawares. They crept in unawares. In fact, that expression is from one Greek word. And this word is made up of, actually, it's a combination word made up of three Greek words, which means beside, in, and into, or to sink into. So they came in, they just sort of sank in unawares. They came in beside, in unawares. And that's what we're warned against here. Can we be watchful then for false teachers as diligently as the Bible commands and be ecumenical at the same time? I ask you, friends, according to the Bible, can we? No. I don't think so. To be on the outlook for these false teachers and false prophets and to diligently compare their teachings with the Scripture is contrary to the liberal emerging church and the ecumenical philosophy. Now, the ecumenical philosophy is refuted by the Bible's command also to separate from error. The Bible is our standard, isn't it?
Amen.
I tell you, there was a news article that came out on CNN, and I didn't take time to put it in the presentation, but it came out, I think it was this last Thursday. Have you ever heard of an entertainer called Lady Gaga?
Yeah.
She claims to be a Christian. She claims to be a Christian. And she was condemning the vice president and his family because the vice president and his wife, they don't believe in the LGBT movement. They believe it's sin. They believe it's wrong. Okay? And she was saying that's not Christianity. Christianity is accepting people and receiving people and not being prejudiced. You know, my Bible tells me that Jesus will receive any sinner who comes to him. Amen? Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
But does he leave them as sinners? Does he leave them in their filth and their degradation? Of course not. But she was saying, you know, that this is Christianity. And someone was writing this opinion. They said, you know, this is what enlightened Christianity is about. We need to get away from that old medieval Christianity or idea of Christianity that so many of these, quote, fundamentalists still teach today. But it made me think. Okay, so Mr. Pence can claim to be a Christian. Lady Gaga can claim to be a Christian. But what is the standard? How do we know what a Christian is, friends? Can I determine for myself what Christianity is? Can any follower of Muhammad claim to determine what Islam is? Well, no, they would tell you no. They would say we go by the Quran. As Christians, friends, we must have a standard. We must have some basis for what our faith is, right? And the basis of our faith is found in one place and one place only. It's in what? The Word of God, the Bible, isn't it? And so the Bible tells me whether God wants me to stay a homosexual or not. The Bible tells me whether God tells me I should leave that lifestyle or not. Not Lady Gaga or anyone else. So the Bible is our standard for knowing truth. And according to the Bible, we can know truth from error incontrovertibly. And we are responsible to God, friends, for doing so. The Bible says, study to shew thyself approved unto God, a workman that needeth not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth.
Amen.
Not only are we to hold to sound doctrine and contend for the true faith that was once delivered to the saints, but we are to be on the outlook for false teachers. But that alone is not enough. We are to separate from those who teach false doctrines, and this, friends, is incompatible with ecumenicalism. Notice in Ephesians chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 11 through 13, and have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of darkness, but rather reprove them. For it is a shame even to speak of those things which are done of them in secret, but all things that are reproved are made manifest by the light. For whatsoever doeth make manifest is light. Friends, it says that we are to have no fellowship with the unfruitful works of unrighteousness. In 2 Thessalonians 3:14, the Apostle Paul continues this idea. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3 and verse 14. And if any man obey not our word by this epistle, note that man and have no company with him that he may be ashamed. Now I want to just pause. For those people who are in darkness, for those people who are not in obedience to the word of God, such as Paul is speaking about here, we want them saved. God wants them saved. But God knows that they're not going to be saved by hobnobbing with them and making them think that they're doing okay. Saying, you know, your doctrines are just fine, brother, that's good. That doesn't help them. It doesn't save them. Because it's through the truth that we are sanctified, isn't it?
Yes. Thy word is truth.
Sanctify them through thy
truth. Thy word is truth.
Word, thy word is truth. And so we have to do that through the truth. And it's not through error. Ellen White made a statement I want to share with you. She says we shouldn't be warned not to associate with those who by their course of action lay a stumbling block in the way of others. Let me just pause there. People who lay stumbling blocks in the ways of others, they're certainly in a bad position themselves already. But that's not enough. It's when they're also laying stumbling blocks in the paths of others, when they're teaching things that are causing people to be lost. She says, we should not associate with them. And then she makes a quotation from the apostle. If any man obey not our word by this epistle, the apostle says, note that man have no company with him, that he may be ashamed. Yet count him not as an enemy, but admonish him as a brother. If he refuse the admonition of the Lord's servants and follow his own will and judgment under the inspiration of his leader, Satan, he will bring ruin upon himself and must bear his own sin. You know, the Bible says that we are to admonish a heretic once, twice, but it doesn't say you keep doing it over and over and over and over and over. We claim to be people of the book, people of the Bible. We claim that it is important to keep the seventh-day Sabbath because the Bible teaches it. But are we willing to follow all the teachings of the Bible? A brother in the classroom noted earlier Romans 16:17. I'd like to look at that text now. Romans 16:17 and also verse 18. The last chapter of Romans, Romans 16. Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and what?
Avoid them.
Let's get together and have a big ecumenical meeting. We'll have communion together first. We'll just have a good time. We believe that we should keep the seventh-day Sabbath because the Bible says so, right? And we make an emphasis of saying we do this because the Bible says so. But what does the Bible say about this? And are we willing to obey the Bible here? Now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good works and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. Terrible, terrible, terrible. Now, specifically, Paul says to mark those that cause division. Not those who differ on the color of the church carpet or what kind of fellowship meal to have, but those who cause divisions in doctrine. He says that we are to avoid them because by their fair speeches they deceive others. And so, friends, again, are we willing to follow the Bible? Now, I want you to notice the verb in verse 17. He says, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause division, offenses contrary to the doctrine which you've learned, and to do what?
Avoid them.
He says, I want you to avoid them. Now this word, avoid, is a Greek word, but the word is not as important in our discussion right now as the tense and the arrangement of the word. This word is what is considered an active imperative in the second person. Active imperative, the second person. Active means you take action upon it yourself. You are doing the action. Imperative means it must be done. But I want you to notice what one Greek scholar has said about this form of a word. In Basics of Biblical Greek Grammar by William D. Mounce, he says on page 310 of his grammar book, there is no more forceful way in the Greek language to tell someone to do something than a simple imperative, particularly the second person imperative. Let me just pause. In Romans 16, when he says to avoid, that's active second person imperative. Do you get that? And the Greek scholar is telling us that there's no more forceful way in this language to tell someone to do something than a simple imperative, and particularly the second person imperative, especially when such a command is given regarding a specific situation. And is it in Romans 16 a specific situation? Yes, it is. The one giving that command sees himself as an authority figure. He expects those addressed to do exactly as he has ordered. Exactly as he has ordered. Paul says to mark that person, or to keep one's eye upon him or her, and to be sure that that person is not allowed to continue to spread their heresy, or at least you don't provide a forum for it to happen. Paul also speaks about this writing to the church of Thessalonica. In 2 Thessalonians chapter 3, verse 6. 2 Thessalonians 3:6. He says, now we command you, brethren, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you withdraw yourselves from every brother that walketh disorderly, and not after the tradition which he received of us. chapter 2 and verse 15 in the same book. Wherefore, brethren, stand fast, hold the traditions which ye have been taught, whether by word or our epistle. So when he's speaking about traditions, he's speaking about their teachings, but those teachings could have come from either his epistles or the word, the Old Testament, that he's already been preaching to them.
Wait, verse?
2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 15. Verse 15. Now, in the book of Revelation, and particularly the 14th chapter, we have what we call the three angels' messages. As Adventists, we know those messages fairly well. We know how important they are. And the second angel's message says that Babylon is fallen. And that message joins with the third angel and swells into a loud cry and giving a fourth angel's message in Revelation chapter 18. And in verse 4, there again we learn that Babylon is fallen, but now we have a command, and that is to come out of her, my people. We are to come out of her, my people. Friends, it is diametrically opposed to the three angels' messages and the fourth angel's message to have an ecumenical philosophy or to teach ecumenicalism. It is impossible to practice both at the same time. The truth that is that common orthodox, the truth that is that common orthodox among the ecumenical believers is not the straight truth. Because it's the doctrine of the Trinity. And it's a false doctrine. Now, the ecumenical philosophy is refuted by the Bible's definition of what true Christianity is. As we look at true Christianity, I want you to consider some major passages on Christian unity. Let's first turn to John 17 and verse 21. John 17, verse 21. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. This, you might say, is the flagship text of the modern ecumenical movement. They claim to work for the unity for which Christ prayed. But friends, Jesus does not pray for disunity in doctrine. The context of John 17 destroys the unity myth that the ecumenical church teaches. Jesus plainly stated that the unity for which he was praying is a unity based upon salvation, truth, and separation from the world. Look in verses 6 and 8 now. John 17, verse 6 and 8. He says, I have manifested thy name unto the men which thou gavest me out of the world. Thine they were, and thou hast given them me, and they have kept thy word. Friends, they did what? They kept his word. In other words, they were obedient to the teachings. Verse 8. For I have given unto them the words which thou gavest me, and they have received them, and have known surely that I came out from thee, and they have believed that thou didst send me. He says, I've given them thy words, and they've received them. In verse 14, he says, I have given them what? Thy word. And the world hath loved them. No. Does the world love the Christian?
No.
Friends, you find a Christian is well loved by everybody in the world, watch out, there's something wrong. Because Jesus said that when we have his word, the world hates us. Because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Verse 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Verse 19. And for their sakes I sanctify myself, that they also might be sanctified. How? Through the truth. Friends, the words of Jesus in John 17 are not a unity of true Christians with false. It is not nominal with genuine. It is not sound doctrine with heresy. And neither is it a unity that ignores doctrinal differences for the sake of an inclusive fellowship. In fact, friends, Christ was not praying for man to do anything to create the unity described in his prayer. Read through it. There's no command for anyone to do anything to bring about this unity. Jesus was not preaching, he was praying to his Father. And he was speaking about a spiritual experience for which God is responsible for creating among his truly born-again believers who will use the Scriptures, his Word, as their guide. Jesus was not speaking about a possibility that must be organized by man. Now, Paul plainly spoke about the reality of this Christian experience in 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 10. He says, "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak one common teaching, and everything else you can take what you want on it." What does he say? "Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ," and there's no other greater name that he could beseech them by, "that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same" what? "Mind," or in the same spirit, "and in the same judgment." Biblical unity means having one mind. And this is contrary to the ecumenical movement and their concept of unity in diversity. You ever hear that term? Unity in diversity. The unity of the ecumenical movement, friends, is not true unity at all. It's confusion, and that's Babylon. It's confusion, and that's Babylon. Now let's go back to Ephesians 4. We read some texts in Ephesians earlier. We're going to read verses 3 through 6 now. He says, "Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." How do we do that? "There is one body and one Spirit, even as you are called in one hope of your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all." Friends, this is true biblical unity, not the common ecumenical philosophy. Firstly, true Christian unity is a unity of the Spirit, we read in verse 3. To have a unity of the Spirit means that we are all regenerated by and led by the Spirit of God. But friends, the Spirit of God never leads us contrary to the Word of God.
That's right.
We cannot have this unity if we are simply bringing together anyone and everyone who names the name of Christ, regardless of their actual spiritual condition. I mean, we may as well let Lady Gaga join the church. Now, I'm not condemning Lady Gaga. I don't know that much about her. I saw her in an interview one time. She seemed like a very congenial person. But friends, her music, her concerts, the way she, her deportment, it's not Christian. I'm sorry. It doesn't meet the standards of the Bible. Secondly, true Christian unity is a unity of the one faith, Ephesians 4:5. Biblical unity is impossible apart from the faith once delivered to the saints. And not all doctrines are of equal importance, but friends, but all doctrines are important.
Yes.
Did you get that? Not all doctrines are of equal importance, but all doctrines are important. In Matthew chapter 23, Jesus is speaking here to the Pharisees, and in verse 23, he said some things that seem very harsh, but there's a principle we can notice in what he's saying here. He says, "Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and have omitted the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye to have done, and not to leave the other undone." So Jesus speaks about weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, faith. He says, you didn't do them, you should have. He says, but you shouldn't have left the others undone either. They were all important, but there were some that were weightier than others. And so nothing clearly taught in the Scripture, friends, should be rejected or set aside simply for the purpose of having unity. Now, if we could turn to 1 Timothy chapter 6. And 1 Timothy is a great book. If you haven't read it for a while, I'd encourage you to read it. 1 Timothy chapter 6 and verse 14. He says, "That thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ." He says, you keep this commandment, how? Without spot. You ever get a little spot on your coat? Just seems like a little thing. The Greek word here that's translated spot actually means stain. Stain. You get a stain on it. But the theme of 1 Timothy is the practical functioning church. This is the theme of the epistle. And in this epistle, Paul dealt with things such as church government in chapter 3. He dealt with women's role in the church in chapter 2. And these are some of the things that are typically downplayed in the ecumenical churches. But they say, well, they're just of secondary importance. And yet Paul taught Timothy to keep all of these things, to keep all of these commandments without spot, without a stain, until Jesus comes. As we saw earlier, Timothy was instructed to allow no other doctrine. And friends, that is the strictest standard possible for doctrine. And when one holds that standard of doctrine, it is impossible to be ecumenical in the mildest sense of the word. Going back to Ephesians again, Ephesians 4, verses 11 through 15, Paul says that Christ, when he ascended to heaven, he gave gifts to his church, and he gave some apostles and some prophets and some evangelists and some pastors and teachers. Why did he do this? For the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come, what? In the unity of fellowship. We just have unity of fellowship. That's what Paul wants us to have. That's what Jesus wants to have. He gave us all these gifts so we could have unity of fellowship. But it's not what the text says.
No.
You know, it might seem nice. If I was writing the Bible, I might have wrote it that way. Maybe you'd wrote it that way. But that's not what God says. In the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. And what will this enable us to do and to avoid? Verse 14, that we henceforth be no more children tossed to and fro and carried about with every wind of doctrine. Friends, if all these doctrines are not important, we can just have an ecumenical meeting together. But he says that there are winds of doctrine. We're not to be carried away with them. And God gave gifts to his church so that he could bring his people to a knowledge of the Son of God and to Christian perfection so that they would not be carried away with these winds of doctrine by the sly of men and the cunning craftiness whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Verse 15, But speaking what, Brother Allen? What does the text say? Speaking the truth, how? In love, of course, in love. But sometimes love means that I have to tell you the truth. But speaking the truth in love. I remember one time when I was in college. This is before I became a Christian. I had been imbibing in alcohol, and not a little. Not a little. And my older brother Russ came up to me and says, I have to have a talk with you. I said, what's up? He says, well, he says, I've been talking to some of the other guys that know both of us, and they've been drinking a long time, and they're heavy drinkers, but they think you're going to become an alcoholic. You're drinking so much. I said, no, I'm not going to become an alcoholic. He says, yeah, he says, it's looking bad. I didn't want to hear that at the time, but I'm certainly glad he talked to me, because I quit alcohol at that very moment. I quit alcohol, and I was so glad I did. But he told me what I needed to hear, not what I wanted to hear at the time. He told me the truth. Bless his heart. We have to speak the truth, and it has to be in love, so that we can grow up in all things, which is the head, even Christ. God wants unity among his people, friends. But that unity is to be a unity of truth. In Romans chapter 15 and verse 6, Romans 15, verse 6. We saw a text similar to this earlier. He says, now the God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus, that ye may with one mind and one mouth glorify God, even the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. We saw a text earlier talked about the one mind, the one spirit. And here we have the one mind again, and that we all speak with one mouth the same thing. Friends, this is not ecumenicalism. It's not. The church is to hold fast in one spirit and in one mind. Another text. Philippians. Really close, just a few pages over. Philippians 1:27. He says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. And remember, wait, before I go on. As it becometh the what?
Gospel.
The gospel of Christ. Now, according to the Apostle Paul, and what we read in Galatians chapter 1 earlier, there's a true gospel, but there's also a false gospel, isn't it? There's another gospel, which is not another. And that gospel brings condemnation. It says anathema to those who preach that gospel, right? So when he speaks here that our conversation should be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, it's talking about the genuine article, not a false article. That whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. It's pretty plain, isn't it? Jesus said that he spoke openly to the world. Think about that. In John chapter 18 and verse 20, Jesus answered him, I spake openly to the world. I ever taught in the synagogues and in the temples where the Jews always resort, and in secret have I said nothing. Was Jesus open about what he taught? Absolutely. He had nothing to hide. In Proverbs chapter 1 and verse 20, it says that wisdom crieth in the streets. But if you follow on through the early part of the book of Proverbs and you come to chapter 8, you begin to realize that wisdom is a personification of whom?
Christ.
He crieth in the streets. Beloved, there's no reason to hide the truth, even about this matter of ecumenicalism. And in sharp contrast, it is Satan who tries to hide things. It is Satan who is a liar. In John chapter 8 and verse 44, John chapter 8 and verse 44, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the what?
Truth.
Because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Satan comes to us, friends, as a wolf, but in sheep's clothing. Jesus said in Matthew 7, verse 15, he said, beware of false prophets, which come unto you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly they are ravening wolves. Turn with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Because, friends, Satan is trying to hide his true identity. He is trying to lie about who he really is and what he's doing. And even his ministers appear as angels of light. 2 Corinthians 11, verses 13 through 15. He says, for such are false apostles. Let that sink in. Paul doesn't say that anyone teaching anything they want and teaching in an ecumenical way is a true apostle of Jesus. He says they're false apostles. Deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And he says, don't marvel about this. Why? For Satan himself is transformed into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also be transformed as ministers of righteousness, whose end shall be according to their works. And so, beloved, Satan is using the ecumenical movement to deceive humanity. Ecumenism refuses to identify any minister as being unrighteous. But we see the scripture state that there are fallen angels even coming to people as angels of light. Beloved, we might ever be so sincere, and we might try to unite the people with vast belief differences, but that is not the biblical plan. Remember at the beginning we stated that the World Council of Churches, the emerging church, and others would unite on their single view of God. Do you think Satan, in principle, is going to use this successful plan among the remnant? Oh yes, it's been successful in many other places. You know, you keep doing something successful, you don't quit until for some reason it doesn't work. He's going to use this same plan, and we have to be careful, for the ecumenical movement may be closer than we believe. Beloved, biblical faith is not many separate doctrines, but it is rather one systematic, united body of truth with all the doctrines interlocking together. It is unscriptural and it is unreasonable to think that we can come together with others who have one main point with us, even if that is a vital point. You know, we don't go worship with the Seventh-day Baptists. They keep the Sabbath, don't they? But there are too many other extreme differences that we can't agree with them on. At least that's been the way it has been in the past. But as we've seen, The Apostle Paul instructed Timothy to keep every aspect of biblical truth without spot. Can you give me a higher standard than that? Can you give me a more stringent standard than that? We're to do this until Jesus returns. And I believe he's referring to every detail of the Word of God. And friends, it's impossible to stand unequivocally for all the biblical truth and to be ecumenical at the same time. Someone has said, we will either limit our message or we will limit our fellowship. Could I say that again? We will either limit our message or limit our fellowship. See, when you limit your message, the fellowship can increase. But when you speak a strict message, the fellowship tends to decrease. In 2007, I was at Andrews University for the 50th anniversary of the publication of the book Questions on Doctrine conference. And it's one of the most interesting conferences, I assure you, I've ever been to. All the big heavyweights of Adventist theology were there. There was a group that was there to promote Questions on Doctrine and to approve of the theology of Questions on Doctrine, that apostate book. Okay? Be very clear about that. And there was another group, in antithesis to that group, that was speaking against the theology of that book. So you had people on this side like Dennis Fortin, George Knight, some of those Adventist theologians, and they're saying what great theology that this book was teaching and how vital it was for our Christian experience. And on the other side, you had people like Colin Standish, Russell Standish, and others that were saying, no, this book is not teaching old-time Adventism at all. It's a new theology, it's a new faith, and we can't accept it. Amen. And they're basically, all through the week, kindly, with gentle words, but basically saying, in effect, the teachings that they're giving you are Antichrist, and over here they're saying the teachings they're giving you are Antichrist. That's what they said all week long. You were there, you heard it, isn't that right? But you know what they did on Sabbath? On Sabbath, they came together for a communion together among themselves. And at the communion table, George Knight and Colin Standish served the sacred emblems of Christ together, each believing the other is serving a false Christ. Ecumenicalism, it may be closer than you think. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, Jesus said, enter ye in at the strait gate, for wide is the gate, and broad is the way that leadeth to destruction, and many there be which go in thereat. Verse 14, because strait is the gate, and narrow is the way that leadeth into life, and few there be that find it. Jesus says there's two gates. There are two ways. We can't have both. Now the Greek word for strait is stenos, and it means narrow. It means narrow. But there's a different Greek word that's translated narrow. Philebo. And it means to cause someone to suffer trouble or hardship. To cause trouble to, or to persecute, to cause to suffer hardship. Isn't that interesting? And it's translated in various ways. It's translated troubled, afflicted, narrow, throng, suffer tribulation. So, in other words, Jesus is saying that straight and hard is the way which leadeth unto life. And Paul said this as much the same thing. In fact, this word is used in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 8. I'll show you a couple places. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8. For we are what?
Troubled.
Troubled. But the Greek word that's translated troubled here is the same word that's translated narrow in Matthew 7:14. It means to suffer trouble or hardship, and that's what's being used here in Paul, by Paul, in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 8. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not despaired. In 1 Thessalonians 3, 4, he says, for verily, when we were with you, we told you before that we should suffer tribulation. Same word. Even as it came to pass, and you know. So friends, the way of the Christian is not the way that's easy. It's not the way that's wide and broad. It's the narrow way. It's the hard way. But friends, it's the good way. It's the good way. Jesus is a good taskmaster. He's a good master. And he knows what we need. He knows what our experience needs. And we need to imitate him and imitate his practice in preaching too. Do you remember when Jesus was resurrected and he's walking on the road to Emmaus with two disciples? You remember the story? And if we would turn back to Luke 24 and just read a verse. Luke 24 and verse 27. And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded them in all the scriptures, the things concerning himself. Did Jesus think it was important to use all the scriptures?
Yes.
He said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth in the mouth of God. Matthew chapter 4, verse 4. And so it is imperative, friends, that we study the scriptures, that we study all the scriptures, that we give every verse, every chapter its weight and bearing. Preaching everything in the scriptures will automatically put us in the narrow way to the straight gate. And the choice is clear. If one is faithful to the faith once delivered to the saints, it will be impossible to have a wide fellowship in this final hour. And if one is committed to a wide fellowship, he must be willing to limit his message. I'm not. And I pray you will not. Because it's not the message of Jesus. It's not the message of the Bible. Jesus didn't narrow his message ever. And if we're to be like Jesus, then we cannot narrow our message either. And we cannot be a part of the ecumenical movement. May God bless us, friends, that we will follow him and follow him fully all the days.